Praise the Lord.
Hallelujah.
Let us pray. In Jesus' name.
Amen.
Our Father and our God, we want to bless and magnify your holy name. Jehovah, I want to thank you for a brand new day you have made. We want to thank you that we are alive this day to glorify your name. We join the saints all over the whole world, the angels in heaven, and we thank you for Jesus that came, that truly we might have life. We thank you because the birth of Christ has come to give us life.
Yes.
Now our destiny changed because Christ is alive, Christ is born, we have eternal life forever in Jesus' name.
Amen.
But I thank you for the season we are right now, because of the birth of Christ, events in the world have changed and our life has changed. Our destiny has changed forever in Jesus' name.
Amen.
Praise the Lord.
Hallelujah.
Today we're going to be looking at, we call it the birth of Jesus, the birth of Jesus Christ. Event that changed the world and human destiny. The birth of Jesus Christ. Event that changed the world and human destiny. Can you imagine if Christ was not born? You're listening right now all over the whole world. This is a major holiday that is being celebrated all over the whole world. Whether it's a Christian nation, whether it's an unbelieving nation, whether it's a pagan nation, whether it's a Muslim nation, all over the whole world, people are celebrating this major event, the birth of Christ. And businesses are making billions upon billions upon billions of dollars all over the whole world. The merchandise are rejoicing all over the whole world for a single reason, the birth of Christ. Let us go back to history and let us look at Jesus Christ. Before Jesus was born, the birth of Jesus was not an accident. It was a preordained event. Way, eternity past. There was a plan in heaven for Jesus to be born. Because God foresaw the depravation of man, the sin that man was in. Man could not redeem himself. And for that reason, God had to send a Savior to redeem the world. And when the event was mentioned in heaven, there was a war. As I told us last week, one of these angels, it was called Lucifer. It was called Bright Morning Star. He was not happy. He rebelled against God because he was going to be subject to this new authority. Even Christ was the third, the second in power, in the triune God, God the Father, God the Son, and God the Holy Spirit. But Satan was not willing because he had to make himself lower than the angel. He said, oh, I don't want to give up my position. He actually challenged God. There was war in heaven. As we saw last week, the first war that was fought was in heaven. And the time did pass. The second war was when the whole earth was destroyed. Genesis chapter 1 verse 1. And that one destroyed everything that God made. And God recreated the world again. And God destroyed it again with water. This time right now, God is going to destroy this world with fire. Oh, I say, fire? Yes. This world will be destroyed by fire. So don't lay your egg. Don't build your mansion. Don't build your palace. Don't build your eternity on this world. Our home is in heaven. A new heaven and new earth, where we're going to live with God forever. In the only time, such a thing never exists. The only thing about paradise that we're going to live with God, it was never in a human existence. So before that time, God made a promise to David in 2 Samuel, chapter 7, chapter 8, 9, 10, 11, and 12. If you read it, God told David, I'm not going to deal with you as I dealt with Saul, because Saul was rebelled being the first king, and I took all my presence, all my glory away from him. But I'm going to give you a new kingdom, and your king will last forever. What did David want to do? David wanted to build a mansion for God. God said, I don't need your house. Your child after you that will come from your loin will be the one to build the world for me. God. God does not like dirty business. No, there are no people who go to steal, who do prostitution. They want to bring the money to the church. As a pastor, have nothing to do with their money because we are going to leave everything behind. God does not take dirty business. God is not in the dirty business. Guess what happened? He said, your son, who will know peace, will be the one to give me that mansion. Is your hand clean? Is your heart clean? God is looking at our hand. And I said, David, your kingdom will reign forever. This is what Jesus came to fulfill. So when Jesus was born, he has to come through the lineage of David because he's going to be a king forever. And God has to look for somebody who is clean to be used. And you know, in those days, like so many cultures today around the whole world, guests are not clean. I'm sorry to say that. A lot of people are involved in so many sexual activity, and God cannot use them. And because they're not clean, God cannot use them. God was looking for a clean girl who he will use. And there was a council in heaven, we are searching all over the whole world. God looked at the heart of man. It's your heart, right? Well, we can go to each other, but you know your heart is not right with God. God knows his heart is not right with you. So God was searching the whole world. Searching the whole world, looking for a person. Of course, the whole world had a little God. Their knowledge of God was very dark, was very faint. Like somebody looking through a dark telescope, looking into a dark future. They didn't know the way you and I know about God today, they didn't know anything about God at that time. So there was a little girl that was found, Mary. Every that girl, God will not use them. Let us go back to the Bible, Luke chapter 1. So we're going to look at Luke chapter 1, how this young girl was found.
We're going to Luke chapter 1, starting from verse 26. The birth of Jesus foretold.
Now, can you go to your Bible with me, please? We are reading from NLT. Our reading will be different from yours, but we are going to end up in the same place. You don't worry. Whatever your words say, we're going to end up in the same lane. We're going to land at the same destination. So take your Bible with me, please. Luke chapter 1, verse 6.
Starting from verse
26.
Luke chapter 1, starting from verse 26. In the sixth month of Elizabeth's pregnancy, God sent the angel Gabriel to Nazareth, a village in Galilee, to a virgin named Mary. She was engaged to be married to a man named Joseph, a descendant of King David. Gabriel appeared to her and said, "Greetings, favored woman, the Lord is with you." Confused and disturbed, Mary tried to think what the angel could mean. "Don't be afraid, Mary," the angel told her, "for you have found favor with God. You will conceive and give birth to a son, and you will name him Jesus. He will be very great and will be called the Son of the Most High. The Lord God will give him the throne of his ancestors David, and he will reign over Israel forever. The kingdom will never end." Mary asked the angel, "But how can this happen? I am a virgin." The angel replied, "The Holy Spirit will come upon you, and the power of the Most High will overshadow you. So the baby to be born will be holy, and he will be called the Son of God. What's more, your relative Elizabeth has become pregnant in her old age. People used to say she was barren, but she has conceived a son and is now in her sixth month. For nothing is impossible with God." Mary responded, "I am the Lord's servant. May everything you have said about me come true." And then the angel left her. The word of the Lord.
Thank you to God. Now, the angel left her. Let us look at this place. He said, "Mary, you have found favor with God." You know, finding favor with God is very difficult. I tell people all the time, I say, we all go to church. We all are children of God, but we are not God's children. God gave birth to all of us. God created all of us. But in his scheme of things, we are not all children of God, because there are devil children in this world. So Job was searching the whole world, looking for a beautiful girl. And she found a young, beautiful girl. And when she found this beautiful girl, who was a virgin, and they said, "We are favored because of your lifestyle, because of the life you have been leading. You are favored one." There was a big search. And when this girl was not called the favored one, it's a tremendous blessing for God to say, "You are favored." It's not easy to be favored by God, or it's not easy for God to say, "You are favored." But Mary was found, said, "You are favored." And he also gave, you know, God had to give testimony. If you don't know God so much, you know, when pastors are preaching, or when they were in Bible school, they always say, you give current events to encourage others of what is going on. He said, Elizabeth is pregnant. That was a testimony. Mary knew that her cousin or her auntie had been married for years. There was no child. But this time right now, she wanted to make sure that she's aware. No other person knew that Mary was pregnant. It was a secret, secret. But God revealed to Mary, who was far away, and said, your auntie, Mary, Elizabeth is pregnant. This will encourage you that with God, all things are possible. I don't know what problem you are going through today. I don't know what sickness you'll be having. I don't know what financial problem you may be in. I don't know what difficulty you may be having in your life. Remember, nothing is impossible with God. As I always say, because you have a hard time today, maybe you don't have a job, maybe you're looking for a husband, maybe you're looking for a wife, maybe you're looking for a house, maybe you're looking for anything. Maybe you want to move to a different city. Whatever you're looking for, remember, nothing is impossible with God. All that God wants you to do is to believe. You know, believe is the hardest thing. You know, Zechariah, when you look at this first passage of this scripture, Zechariah was a man of God, a priest, an ordained priest, who had been ministering God forever. But Zechariah said, "God, I don't want this baby." John. Gabriel said, "Do you know who is talking to you?" He said, "An old man. I have been praying for years. I don't need this baby right now." God said, the angel said, "Do you know who is talking to you? I am Gabriel. I stand in the presence of God Almighty. And God Himself sent me to give you this message. You are doubting this message? Listen, you are going to be a dumb man. You are not going to speak. Or did this message come?" Why was the angel pronouncing that judgment? The angel was not given the power to pronounce the judgment. But the angel pronounced the judgment because this man was talking with his blessing. But here's little Mary. She really didn't know nothing about God. She's a clean little virgin girl. If you go back to our culture, all over the whole world, young girls at a very young age, if we take statistics, they are not virgin. In this country, a lot of girls are having sex at the age of 13, at the age of 12. And they make themselves caricature by what they wear, by how they dress, and how they expose their body. Young girls, and they also put themselves in a hell of danger, because their bodies are attracted to men. They palm their head, they make their face, they expose their breast, they show part of their legs. These are attracted to men. That's very dangerous. And that made them to be sexually active at a young age. But Mary kept herself. In that culture, that time, people used to get married at a very young age. But Mary was espoused to be married. But she kept herself. She was betrothed to be married to a young man. Both of them were walking towards a marriage. But all of a sudden, the angel of the Lord came and said, "Mary, you are a favored woman. Am I favored because I'm going to get married? Am I favored because of what?" Mary was confused. He said, "What is going on?" He said, "Listen, you are favored by God. The Lord God is going to bless you. You are going to be pregnant." Number one, she was engaged to a man who is from the David lineage. Remember 2 Samuel chapter 7, chapter 8, chapter 9, chapter 10, all the way to chapter 14. God was dealing with David. David wanted to build God a temple, a beautiful house, because he was living in a beautiful palace made of cedar. The Lord told him to Nathan prophet, he said, no, David, I don't want to build it for me. But there's going to be somebody who will come after you. And I'm going to establish your kingdom forever. David wanted to do one thing for God, but God was giving him a tremendous blessing. You know, when you serve God faithfully, I tell people all the time, serving God is a tough business. Being a pastor is one of the hardest jobs, but there's tremendous reward. The reward is not on this earth. Our reward is in heaven. Are you serving God faithfully? Are you following God? Are you truly obedient to God with all of your heart? You know, there are people that serve God with one leg in the church, one leg outside. Everybody knows them as a party man, as a party girl. Every club in the town knows them. Every person in the town knows them as a happy man, as a happy woman. Because whenever there's a party in town, this person is always there. He likes to dance, he likes to drink, he likes to involve with whatever people are not Christians are doing. He also comes to church. He wants to do the same thing. You cannot serve God and the devil at the same time. You have to choose. Do you want to serve God? You know, Jesus said, if you serve God, people will hate you. People are going to neglect you. People are going to despise you. He said, but great is your reward in heaven because your heavenly Father is filled with your life. So maybe was told, you're a favored woman, and your desire is going to come from the lineage of David. This baby that is to be born is going to be a king forever. And that was the promise God made to David. If you listen to Samuel, that promise that was made to David is going to be fulfilled. It's going to be your lineage, David, God said, going to be a king forever. Jesus is a king forever. Jesus is going to reign and his reign right now forever. And he's coming back again as a second time, as a true king and a warrior to rule this earth. And after ruling this earth, this earth will dissolve and a new heaven and new earth will come. And that's where all the believers who have no God forever are going to live forever. May God help us in Jesus' name. Do you know Jesus? So Jesus is born during this period. That was the event that changed the world. So Mary was happy. She said, let it be to me according to your word. I'm your handmaid. Are you telling God? I'm your servant. I have submitted my life to Christ. God, do with me as you will. You know, one of the most dangerous prayers to pray is to say, God, do with me as you want. You know, when I was pastoring the church, people come to the altar, they are praying, God, oh God, please do with me as you want. I said, stop. You know what you're asking? What if God say, quit your job? God say, go and sell your house and give the money to the ministry. What if God say, you're not going to get married? Oh, no. Pastor, that's not a matter. Well, the letter what you're asking. Because, do with me. But this young girl will say, God, I'm your vessel. Do with me as you want. She's a young girl right now. She's not married. She's engaged to be married. And she's not going to be pregnant. What a shame. A young girl who's not married. Can you imagine 2,000 years ago? How are you going to tell your family member? How are you going to tell your father? How are you going to tell your mother? How are you going to tell your friends? Here's your daughter. She's not pregnant. Oh my God. But God also responds. He said, the word of God will never fail. That is true. Every word in the Bible, every lawyer, every line, every judge will never respond. Mary said, I am the Lord's servant. May everything I have said come true to me. And the angel left her. The angel was not happy. He went to heaven. Let's look at chapter 2, please.
Starting from verse 1.
Chapter 2. Luke chapter 2.
Luke chapter 2, starting from verse 1.
Please, turn your Bible with me to Luke chapter 2.
At that time, the Roman Emperor Augustus decreed that a census should be taken throughout the Roman Empire. This was the first census taken when Quirinius was governor of Syria. All returned to their own ancestral town to register for this census. And because Joseph was of a descendant of David, he had to go to Bethlehem. He had to go to Bethlehem in Judea, David's ancient home. He traveled there from the village of Nazareth in Galilee. He took with him Mary, his fiancée, who was now obviously pregnant. And while they were there, the time came for her baby to be born. She gave birth to her first child, a son, she wrapped him snugly in stripes of cloth and laid him in a manger, because there was no lodging available for them. That night, there were shepherds staying in the fields nearby, guarding their flocks of sheep. Suddenly, an angel of the Lord appeared among them, and the radiance of the Lord's glory surrounded them. They were terrified, but the angel assured them, "Don't be afraid," he said. "I bring you good news that will bring great joy to all people. The Savior, yes, the Messiah, the Lord, has been born today in Bethlehem, the city of David. And you will recognize him by this sign. You will find a baby wrapped snugly in stripes of cloth lying in a manger." Suddenly, the angel was joined by a vast host of others, the armies of heaven, praising God and saying, "Glory to God in highest heaven, and peace on earth to those with whom God is pleased." When the angel had returned to heaven, the shepherds said to each other, "Let's go to Bethlehem. Let's see this thing that has happened, which the Lord has told us about." They hurried to the village and found Mary and Joseph, and there was the baby lying in the manger. After seeing him, the shepherd told everyone what had happened and what the angel had said to them about this child. All who heard the shepherd's story were astonished, but Mary kept all these things in her heart and thought about them often. The shepherds went back to their flock, glorifying and praising God for all they have seen and all they have heard and seen. It was just as the angel had told them. The word of the Lord.
Thank be to God. Brothers and sisters, this little passage we are reading right now is very exciting and it conceals a lot of information. There was this king who thought he has the power. I don't know if you are working with some people who think, "Oh, I am the president of this country. I am the president of this company. I have all the power." You know, Emperor Augustus thought he was in charge. But he didn't know he was fulfilling God's will and God's order. That's why whatever that happened to you, don't be afraid. Don't get worried. God is working on your behalf. Things may not turn out the way you want them. Here is a young girl. She's not married. She's pregnant. All of a sudden, she has to travel to a distant country. This girl does not have a car. There were no horses, and there were no aeroplane. There was no way for this girl to go there. But they had to travel by barefoot and a horse. And it was very painful for them to go through the hill, the valley, and the rocky places. All of a sudden, guess what? They are obeying a king's order, like the IRS or like the United States Congress. They make a law. See, everybody in this country has to go back to their local government area where they were born, or where they entered the United States originally, either, or where they started their first residency. If they were not born in the US, everybody has to go and register there and pay their taxes to make sure they verify that they have paid their salary or their property tax. Can you imagine? This young girl is pregnant and she's not even married yet. And this man, who is not the father of this child, has a parable. Augustus thought he was in charge, but God was in charge. As I say, the birth of Jesus Christ, event that changed the world and human destiny forever. If you don't know Christ, please, I appeal to you and I urge you at this time, I invite you to look Jesus Christ as Lord and Savior, because if you haven't known him, your destiny is not in good hands. Your destinies are not in good hands. If you know Christ, your destiny is assured.
Yes.
We are temporary residents in this world. This is not our permanent home. So don't worry about what is going on in this world. Don't let this world disturb you. Don't let whatever is going on here disturb you. No, some people are, during this Christmas, they are getting exhausted because they are shopping. They are getting depressed because they don't have money to buy gifts. Everybody is exchanging gifts. Nobody to call them. Nobody to give them a gift. Nobody to give them nothing. And they are so depressed, and some people are committing suicide, and some people are not happy because of the event that is going on in this period. Brothers and sisters, the Christmas is not about buying a gift. Please listen to me and listen carefully. It's not about exchanging your gift. Although they are good themselves. I do give gifts to people, and people do give gifts to me also and my family. But it's not about gift giving. The birth of Christ is to bring tremendous joy. To bring tremendous joy to the people of all the whole world in the earth. Everybody is happy this time. Even when there is war, people are killing each other. They stop this period. They say, hey, you're my enemy over there. I want to kill you. But this time, can we stop killing each other? Let us come together in this war area. Let us just celebrate the birth of Christ. The man of peace. Let us celebrate. Let us come together. And they actually come together. In the war, you see soldiers. They put their gun on. They are enjoying themselves. They are celebrating, they are laughing. As on that, when I watch the video, I laugh. I say, these are people who want to kill themselves. But now, they are laughing. They are drinking. They are celebrating. Because that's what Jesus came to do on earth, to bring peace. But then they were to keep the long story short, they had to travel to their respective village. Because, of course, some sisters have said that now. But prophecy has already been said in the past. In the distant Bible, Isaiah and other people who were looking into the future with their telescope, very darkly, he said, a virgin is going to give birth to a baby. And this is going to be called Emmanuel, God with us. And it's going to be born in Bethlehem of Judea. If this law was not passed, there is no way Joseph and Mary would have gone to Bethlehem. Oh, God is in charge, brothers and sisters.
Amen.
I don't know what you are going through right now. God is in charge.
Yes.
You know, in the office, your manager may say, oh, I'm in charge. I laugh sometimes. Sometimes, when I used to go to the office, somebody, we were having a, what they call town hall meeting, or skip. And they want to come in the morning, hey, listen guys, I'm in charge here, I want you guys to listen to me. And guess what? I would just be laughing. And I remember that time, this is our executive president, Ed. He said, Mr. Marshall, why are you laughing? I said, I just like what you are saying. It's very exciting. I'm very happy that you're in charge here. He said, thank you very much. Thank you. Thank you. I said, you're welcome, sir. You're welcome, sir. He said, I really like when you talk like that. I like that. But in my heart, I want this guy to know that he's not in charge. God is in charge. So, whosoever that is telling you is in charge, isn't it? God thought he was in charge, but God was behind the scene. Prophecies have been made. Years and years back has to be fulfilled. So everybody had to go to their native town, their ancestral home. And this is a descendant of David, King David. Remember, this baby had to be born in Bethlehem. How will it happen? David's ancient home. He went there, and when they came, Mary delivered. You know, in the world, there are people who are despised. There are people who are neglected. People don't respect them. Because they don't have a good job, they don't dress well. Even when they come to a church, please go dress over there. Somebody is already sitting on this chair. And somebody is already sitting here. Look at the way this person dress. Please move over there. Okay, brother, come. Let me come and show you the seat. They take the person back to the seat. The person that dressed, God just the one is coming. They put him here. You know, from Azimuth of God background. So when the brother dressed gorgeously, you say, brother, come, let me take the usher, will bring you, yeah. Brother, come and sit down here. Yeah, get up, you, yeah, follow me. Yeah, come and sit over here. Oh, I say, God, I pause. Because this brother just purchased it, but this one, brother just got it. This one has money. He's going to give us a big offering. And so he made the whole thing very interesting. This brother will say, praise the Lord, I'm giving a testimony today. I'm giving 1,000, 2,000. Hey! Everybody will be clapping hands. But that poor brother that come to the church and with dirty clothes, brother, come here, my sister. Follow me. Now come and see, go on. Go and put him on the back of the seat in the church. He came early to church, but we put him on the back. These shepherds were not in the society in Israel. Shepherds did not bath. They are smelling like their sheep or their goat or whatever they were keeping charge of, their sheep or whatever. And they don't even go to church, they don't pay tithes, they don't give offering. So they were despised in society. And they cannot speak. They just with their sheep. Day and night. So nobody even recognized them. They don't exist in Israel history. If we are taking census, don't count them. They're not part of us. They're not from this country. We don't like, you know, like census in this country. When they're taking census in America, they don't count illegal aliens. When the last time I said US census is almost about 350 million, it's more than 350 million. It's probably about 450 million because there are a lot of people living in this country who are hiding, who are not US citizens. You know, they sent me the form in the email. They emailed me. They said, go ahead and this all you put in. The form is already pre-filled. Man, just to click. You have a master's, you have a degree. Yeah, what's your level of education? I have an MBA. What is the level of education of your wife? She has a bachelor's degree. What is the level of your education of your son? That time he was in the college. What is the level of education of your children? Then in elementary school. And what is you guys combined income, family income, you put it there. And they asked me another thing. And how long have you been in your house? I put it there. At the end of the day, you submit it. He said, well, if we find any variance, we'll get back to you. I submitted it and I heard anything from them. So that was my census. So you find that some people are afraid to fill the form. If I fill immigration is good, now I'm here, I don't want to fill it. Or they don't even have the email, they don't pay taxes. If you don't pay tax, they may not have information about you. So nobody just in this country, they are invisible. You don't want anybody to know they are here. So the shepherds were like that. They are invisible. But the baby now was born, and while the baby was to be born, the baby did not have any place to stay. Nobody cared, but because they were poor people also. Joseph and Mary were poor, they were capital. God is not looking for reason. But Mary was pure. She was a virgin. Meaning she had never slept, she never had sex with any man. As I told us yesterday, there's a culture in most of the African country. When you go to the part of the eastern Nigeria, there's what they call fat room. They put this young girl here, who is to be married, they begin to feed her, begin to pump her breast, begin to massage her stomach and everything, so that they're able to give birth to a baby. And they do so many things to her, into her vagina and private part, so they can go to marry and have good time with her husband. Or husband have good time with her. So Mary was not exposed to that. As I said before, a lot of young girls in this country, 12, even 10 years old, they're already involved with Elijah's donkey. Mary was not like that. Mary was very clean. She was a pure virgin. And for that reason, she was chosen and she was favored by God. As I always say, God does not bless his enemies. You want God to bless you? You must live a clean life. You cannot live a double life. People send me a lot of video all the time. People go to church, pastor pray for me, they go to kidnap somebody. They go to steal. They go to do armed robbery. They go to do prostitution. Pastor is praying for them. And when they bring money to the church, the pastor take it. The pastor is renting a big car. He lives in a big house. God forbid. As Apostle Paul said, Peter said, when man said, give me the money so I can receive this gift of the Holy Spirit. Whosoever I lay my hand upon, I can speak a tongue. He said, what are you talking about? The gift of God is not to be saved. May you perish with your money. This is your evil thoughts. You are going to be blind. You're going to destroy you. He said, please forgive my sin. I'm sorry. Because Peter said, the thought of your heart is evil. Your heart is not clean. Brothers and sisters, is your heart clean with God? I'm not asking you to go to church. Don't misunderstand me. Is your heart clean in your business? In your daily affair? In whatever you do? God sees everything you and I are doing. I don't know what you are doing. You don't know what I'm doing. But God sees what you are doing. You know, when I go to a store, I see a lot of young girls going into a man like, well, look at this girl, what is she looking for? This girl is looking for trouble. And a lot of girls have been killed in this dollar culture here, all over the whole United States. Because when they are too exposed to their body, men are going to abuse them and men are going to kill them. A lot of young girls, they have been killed because they expose their body. I don't know what they're looking for. Maybe they're looking for money, they want to appear nice, they dress like crazy, like a dog. What are you looking for? What you think of your body, your head? And their finger, they look like the lizard or witchcraft finger. They put this artificial something, very long claw. When I look at it, I say, oh God, what is this? And then when I'm looking at it, I say, what is this? How come my hand is on it? You say, no, this is not a real hand, this is a fish. I say, why do we put this one on? What is the benefit? If you put this one, what does it? You say, well, it just makes you look beautiful. Why? Some people paint their hair with different color, and some people paint their face, and they expose half of their breast. I'm saying, what are you looking for? Young girl, what are you looking for? He said, well, nowhere we want to fit into society, and they wear very tiny little pants, or very little tiny skirt. When they see that, you will see their private part. What are you looking for? You left home like that. Mary was not like that. Mary was clean. Mary was a girl that shouldn't know God. And I gave herself to God. And God honored her today all over the whole world. We respect Mary. You know, Joseph was also a very good man. As I said last week, he was an honorable man. Are you an honorable man? A lot of men would have abandoned Mary. A lot of men are abandoning their children today. They are happy bobo, you know, like this happy dog. He pregnant all the female dogs on the street. And there were so many little puppy dogs on the street. And they don't have no father. And this puppy dog become wild. They started attacking everybody. But that other dog, with their mother or their father is going to look for a job or food, and the mother stayed with the little puppy. But the other one, the mother left them to go and look for food. This puppy dog are attacking everybody on the street. They are running from house and looking for food to eat. And people are, little dog, and bam, attack the dog. And the dog become wild. He's used to beating. And they want to attack people to get something. That's a lot of children have today. They are like, the happy papa give birth to them. And they're like, wild dog. That's why we have so much crime in society. And you see so many girls, they don't have no training. They are so wild. Like animal, of course, they will never have a husband. Of course, they don't have no husband. But nobody will marry such a wild girl. A girl that have a hand like a claw, pen like a dog. Who's going to carry such a girl? Nobody. You and I will not marry such a person as a man. When we look for a girl, we look for a girl who is decent, who is clean. That's what God is also looking for. The God helps us in Jesus' name. I don't know if you have a daughter, please talk to them, let them know Christ. Official person of your name, your face. Exposing your body is not going to give your husband a blessing. It may lead to early death. The God helps Jesus' name. So that night, shepherds were staying in the open field. They were not sleeping. God looking for men and women who are dedicated. Are you able to read your Bible? I say all the time, God can never talk to you. If you don't have time to read your Bible, if you don't have time to sit down and concentrate on the Word of God, you begin to read your Bible. You begin to read it. God will talk to you. You know, when I see that shopping one day, this my Christian sister said, I was in the church. He said, Pastor, for the first time, he wanted to give offering in the church. He said, God told her, don't give me this money. What? I'm in the church, I want to give offering. He said, go to Pastor Marshall's house. Go and give him money. Am I hearing from the devil? No, you're not hearing from the devil. God is talking to you. He said, I left the church and drove all the way to Pastor Marshall's house. He didn't meet me in the house because that time I used to go from place to place to go and minister. I pick all my kids, not brothers in there. We're all going as a family. We all go together. So she didn't meet me in the house. She wrote a check and put it in one of my car outside. Well, I'm not explaining anything. It was there for 3 days. It was raining. One day I was taking my son to the school, I was backing out of the garage. I saw somebody put paper in there. I said, the person is crazy. This guy is a trash car. I look at the person's handwriting. I said, I recognize his handwriting. I open it. There was a check inside. I said, Pastor, this is for you. This is not for the ministry. That's how God taught to us. God can never talk to you if you are not dedicated to Him. If you are not thinking of Him, God can talk to you right now, this face and say, you see that homeless shelter? God gives somebody food there. You see that hungry man? He may even tell somebody in your village, in Nigeria, to send them money. Ah, no, I'm not going to do it. No way, God. This is my money. This morning, I was watching a YouTube WhatsApp status after I read the Bible over and over. And I saw this sister. People were praying for her. One of these Christian sisters. People were praying for her. Say, God will bless her because she sent money to us to do Christmas. And they were praying for her. And I'm saying, well, I guess this people will have a lot of money. No, she doesn't have the money. It's just the love in her heart. That is what Christmas is all about. Sharing the joy of Christ with others. So, is God talking to you? God has spoken to this sister or this woman and said, send this money to these people in the village. It's not that she has the money. Whenever you have prayed this morning, God will bless you. God will never forget you. Whenever you put your hand, God is going to bless you. That's a true prayer because she's not requesting anything from them. She's just giving to them. These sisters are living in a distant land away. And this person also living in a distant land away. They may never cross each other's path again. Unless by God's power or something. But she sent this money to them. And they were praying for her. The prayer was very touched, was very touching. Is God blessing you? Is God talking to you? God went and talked to this angel. This shepherd, I mean. The angel came to him and said, there's a good news. And when they saw the angel, they were terrified. You know, who would not be terrified? Who would not be terrified? A brother wanted to visit me one day. When we finished prayer in the night, I locked my door. I told all my visitor, don't touch the door till the morning. We finish our morning prayer. This brother wanted to go and touch the door. He said he saw a huge man. The man was pulling his sword, pointing to him. He said he was frightened, he was terrified. He said he was almost melting. He said, oh my God, oh my Israel, Africa, couldn't sleep. When he did break, I said, do anybody have any dream? Do we have anything to share? I should sleep throughout the whole night. He said, yeah, how's it? I said, what is it? He said, I saw this huge angel. I said, from where? I asked him, did you touch the dog? He said, yeah. I said, brother, don't do that. Don't kill yourself. He said, truly, this angel must kill me. I said, never you. So this shepherd saw this huge angel. So they were afraid. The angel said to them, don't be afraid. The radiance of God, the presence of God, surrounded the whole area. They were terrified, but the angel assured them. That's one of the blessings of angel. The angel, the true angel of God, will not frighten you. He said, don't be afraid. He said, I bring you good news that will bring great joy to all people. This angel are bringing good news that will bring great joy to all people. The Savior, the Messiah, the Lord have been born today in Bethlehem, the city of David. And you will recognize him by this sign. You will find a baby wrapped sorry in strip of clothes, laying in a manger. Wow, this baby is lying in a manger. He doesn't even have nothing, he's poor. How can the person that is a Christian, is God's child, why will he be born poor? Well, you and I may ask such a question. Brother, the riches is not synonymous with Christianity. All those pastors that tell you, if you give $1,000, God is going to make you to win $500 million lottery. They're not representing heaven. If you give me 1,000, you'll be born again, your child will be born again. That represents heaven. The gift of God is not for sale. Miracle is not for sale. People that God used, they are very humble, they are very quiet, they don't broadcast their stupidity over the air anywhere. They don't advertise themselves. So this angel told the shepherd, and suddenly the angel was joined by a vast host of others, the armies of heaven, armies on the land of God, armies of heaven, praising God and singing praise. There are choirs of army. I was watching the mission yesterday where all these soldiers all over the whole branches of the United States were singing Christmas song and praising God. And the angels and the heavenly soldiers, they were singing glory to God in heaven and in the highest of peace on earth and to those with whom God is pleased. When God is pleased with you, you have peace. That's a sign of God is with you. The peace is the umpire. If you don't have peace, then if you want to do, don't go in for it. The umpire is peace. When you have peace, God is in your heart. So when the angel has returned to heaven, the shepherds said, oh, they said to each other, let us go to Bethlehem. Let us go and find out what happened to this, what has happened. this thing that God has told us about. Are you the person that keeps the story to yourself? Will God tell you something? Jesus actually said, I'm going to do it right now. The shepherd did their sheep. They were poor people. They didn't have money. They were not rich. We're going to find later next week how the rich people also come from a distant land. They bring real gold, present, precious things to honor this newborn baby. God, it doesn't mean you are rich, God cannot talk to you. It doesn't mean you are rich, God cannot bless you. I'm only just telling you, sometimes people are very humble, who the society despise, that the first people God talked to. See Mary, she was not painting her face, she was not beautiful, she was just a little girl, because of your favor. Are you favored? They hurried to the village and found Mary and Joseph, and there was a baby lying in a manger. After seeing him, the shepherd told everyone what has happened and what the angel had said to them about the child. All who heard the shepherd's story were astonished, but Mary kept all these things in her heart and thought about them often. The shepherd went back to their flock, glorified God and praising God for all they have seen, for they have had and seen, just as the angel told them. You see now, the shepherd didn't have money. They could not give, the mother anything. But they just announced. But they are going to see like who are coming later on, who are going to bring gold. Everybody that comes to church may not have money. So some people come to church, they just want to serve, but they don't have no money. It's not a crime if you cannot give. That's what I always say. Don't let your heart be destroyed if you cannot give. If you can give, that's fine, give. If you cannot give, don't worry. You are not committing any crime. So we go ahead and put Jesus' name. In brothers and sisters, this is a season of joy. Are you joyful? Is your heart filled with joy? Are you rejoicing? Are you happy? If you're not happy, there's something wrong. This world is not our home. Don't let the material things of this world disturb you. I don't know what's happening in your country. You may be listening to this in Africa, in South America, and all over the whole world. Oh, Pastor, you don't understand. In my country, we are poor. We don't have nothing. We cannot be happy. No, no, no. Money does not make you to be happy. If money makes people to be happy in America here, a lot of rich people are committing suicide. The people that commit suicide the most are the rich people. They look at their life, they're not rich. So if you know Jesus Christ as your Lord and Savior, rejoice. That's the purpose of Jesus coming to the world. To give us joy. To give us peace. I invite you today, please. Join me to welcome Jesus into your heart. Join me to rejoice. Join me to let Jesus be your Savior. If you have no Jesus, fine, you have no problem. You are in good hand. You are in good hand. Relationship with God and with Christ is the best that will change your destiny forever. That I mean what I'm talking about. If you don't know Christ, oh boy. The church doesn't talk about it today, they only talk about what? There is hellfire. Real hellfire. And people are going to go to hellfire. Oh Pastor, I don't like that. Why are you talking like that? After you don't talk better something, after you don't speak good thing. Why are you talking about hellfire again? This one don't go to church. We're sorry. It's not my word. It's the truth. So I invite you, please, brothers and sisters, give your life to Christ. I want to thank every one of you today for joining us. Bishop could not be able to join us today. He traveled to Los Angeles to spend Christmas with some of his family members there. And I ask God to be with all of you. And I want to wish you Merry Christmas. I want to wish you joy. Wherever you are today over the whole world, whether you are in Africa, in Europe, anywhere you are, may the peace of God fill your heart.
Amen.
May you receive the joy that the Christmas brings. And may the joy that Jesus Christ brings, may it fill your heart and your home. In Jesus' name.
Amen. Away in a manger, no grief for a bed. The little Lord Jesus lay down in sweet hell. The stars in the bright sky look down where he lived. The little Lord Jesus asleep on the hill. The carcass annoyed the baby awakes. But little Lord Jesus, no crying he made. I love you, Lord Jesus, look down from the sky and stay by my side until morning. close by me forever and love me, I pray. Bless all the dear children in your tender care, and fix us for heaven to live with you there. Jesus laid down his sweet hand.
Amen. Brothers and sisters, I want to thank everyone of you for joining us. We have some visitors joining us here today. Pastor John is on the line with us and with his family, and Mrs. Ford also joined us, but she logged off. I think might be having a problem or going somewhere. So I want to thank everyone of us. Every one of you are joining us first of all today. The bishop is not able to join us today. He has traveled to Los Angeles to spend Christmas there with his family. We ask God to be with every one of us in Jesus' name. Pastor John, brother Pastor John,
say hello to
the family for us. Yes.
The Bible says that in the name of thy power, your people shall be wounded.
Yes.
So, Lord, we ask that you will empower us.
Amen.
Lord, you will empower us even to do the right thing. Lord Almighty, not to concentrate only in getting the material things of this world.
Amen.
Deciding the approach that we are the light. We are the light and we are the salt of this world. Father, Lord Almighty, salt comes to uplift and also to preserve. And that is what you expect of us.
Yes, Lord.
That in any circle that we find ourselves, we should uplift. We should add, Lord Almighty, preservation. Father, pray that we will not lack in kind of those functions, because he said that if the salt lost its softness, lost its purpose, it will be useless.
Yes.
We need to be thrown out. I pray that Almighty that we will not lose our softness, we will not lose our purpose, that we will not be thrown away.
Yes, Lord.
In the name of the Lord Jesus.
Amen.
And Lord, you also said in your word that let our light so shine. Let our light so shine that men will see it and glorify you in our God.
Yes, Lord.
That also means that there is a level that our light will shine and it will not do what it's supposed to do. Because it is when our light shine so high, so intense, that men will see that glory. Father, help us not to be lukewarm.
Yes, Lord.
Help us, Lord Almighty, to really bring that to ourselves so that you will shine through us.
Yes, Lord.
In the name of the Lord Jesus.
Amen.
Lord Almighty, we thank you.
Thank you, Lord.
Let us not follow the mundane things of this life and forget the main reason why you have called us, why you have allowed us to be called your children.
Yes, Lord.
For a helpless.
Yes, Lord.
We are helpless. There is nothing we can do on our own.
Yes, Lord.
There is nothing. But the year is fast drawing to an end. A lot of us, we have resolved in our mind what to do next year. we come up with all kinds of resolutions. But alas, we are not able to keep those resolutions. Allah, we ask that you will help us.
Yes, Lord.
That 2026 will not just be like any other year. Allah, you will help us to close strong and open strong in 2023.
Amen.
In the name of Allah Jesus.
Amen.
Father, I thank you for your son. Pray, Lord, that his fountain will not run dry.
Amen.
Pray that his fountain be contaminated.
Amen.
In the name of Allah Christ.
Amen.
Father, Lord, I thank you.
Thank you, Lord.
Father, I pray in your name.
Amen.
Thank you, Father, for the son that has called you, God. The Lord Almighty, they will not lose their reward.
Amen.
You will be blessed in the name of Lord Jesus Christ.
Amen.
Father, I thank you.
Thank you, Lord.
Father, bless you.
Bless you, Lord.
Amen.
Amen. Brothers and sisters, I want to wish you Merry Christmas, and I pronounce every blessing upon you. May you know joy all the days of your life. May you receive Messiah who came to the world to give us joy. May he give you joy and peace in your home, in your marriage, in your job, in whatever you put your hand to do. May that peace that passes all understanding be with you. May the Almighty God, whom you are going to seek, to serve, to love, may he bless you.
Amen.
May he reward you.
Amen.
May he grant you eternal life. This is the final destiny of all mankind. Eternal life with God forever.
Yes.
In the name of Jesus Christ.
Amen.
May God bless us, our going out. May he bless our coming in. May he cause our children to know him.
Yes,
so that we will not go to hellfire. May this society not influence our children negatively. In the name of Jesus Christ.
Amen.
May our children know Jesus, whom we have come to serve all this year. I know all of you have been with us for this many years. May Jehovah God reward you. May he bless you. Today is the last Saturday of 2026. You have labored with us day and night. You have studied the Bible with us day and night. I, Jehovah God, to bless you. I, Jehovah God, to reward you. I, Jehovah God, to prosper you. All the money you have spent this year, Jehovah God will reward you. The time you have spent, Jehovah God will replenish you. All the gifts, all the love, all the favor, all the prayers, all the good things you have done, may the Almighty bless you.
Amen.
May he reward you.
Amen.
May he grant you favor.
Amen.
May he cause men and women to bless you.
Amen.
In the name of Jesus Christ.
Amen.
I raise up my hand unto heaven, from where cometh our head.
Yes.
Our head comes from Jehovah God, who made heaven and earth.
Yes.
I, Jehovah God, to bless you, to reward you, to prosper you. Our children shall rule this country. And they shall be the masters of those that hate us. In the name of Jesus Christ. Our home shall know peace. Our marriage shall know peace. Our children shall know peace. Peace shall dwell in our home. Peace shall dwell in our neighborhood. Peace shall dwell in our heart. Peace shall be our portion. Jesus that brought peace to the earth, may that peace be our portion forever. In Jesus' name. Brothers and sisters, we thank you very much. And we bless every one of you. And we say thank you.
Thank you.
We say thank you.
Thank you.
We are grateful for everything you have done and for what God has used you to do. In Jesus' name.
Amen.
We are grateful for to you and to God.
Amen.
Who have blessed us.
Rejoice, rejoice.
Merry Christmas. Thank you very much.
Merry Christmas to you all. Rejoice in the Lord.
Merry Christmas to every one of you. We appreciate you. We love you. Pastor John, God bless you. God will reward you in the name of the world, in God's nation, in God's world.
Rejoice in the Lord.
grateful and wish a Merry Christmas.